And good morning. This is the class for taxonomy construction. We will discuss about the how to construct, especially taxonomy knowledge domain and their subdomain or elements. Before we go to the categorizations and scheme or common scheme for taxonomy project, let's discuss about the characteristics, because from this characteristic, only then you can identify the types of structure or types of taxonomy component yang boleh kita identify from the knowledge asset. Okay, the first one, taxonomy tend to be less rigid and constrained. For this, you need to know that taxonomy element normally it is advisable for you to construct the flexible, the most flexible taxonomy. So tidak perlu rigid, which mean it can be amended, it can be amended and modified based on timeline. Contohnya after each 3 months or 6 months, or maybe once a year. So you need to revise and amend your taxonomy, and taxonomy must also influence by the usability concerns, which mean you need to minimize the numbers of search or clicks. If you refer to website taxonomy, contohnya berapa banyak klik, ini contohnya bila you search, berapa banyak klik ataupun page to search or to find information that pertaining to your queries. So berapa banyak yang diperlukan, klik yang diperlukan ataupun strategi yang diperlukan to identify the component of knowledge or information that you need. So number of clicks, which mean it depends on the layer of your taxonomy, or level of taxonomy. That's why it is suggested that taxonomy normally depends on level. Quality of taxonomy itu berapa? As I mentioned earlier, the best taxonomy standards is layer between 3 to 5. 3 to 5. Jadi kalau kita kita andaikan sebagai website, kita akan membuat pencarian itu di interface yang berbeza sekitar 3 hingga 5 apa interface sahaja. 3 hingga 5 interface sahaja. Kadang-kadang website ataupun search engine, they tend to provide search or clicks more than five layers. You need to browse, you need to click, navigate dan sebagainya. Only then you can find your apa information as you needed. So kita advise between 3 to 5 level or layer only. And to make sure that contents of knowledge, the knowledge content balance in terms of their distribution. So you must apply the content-driven strategy. Content-driven strategy. That's why for your web taxonomy project, I want you to analyze the knowledge assets in that particular website. Jadi you kena identify apa agaknya tacit and explicit knowledge that reside in your website. Itu kalau website, which mean you kena lihat kepada apa ni content, content of knowledge distributions. So it must be content driven, bukan kepada color system. For example, dia menggunakan color codes or sometimes in our library environment, kita gunakan class number. So kita tidak melihat kepada surrogate information in terms of class scheme or color scheme. We concern more to knowledge asset that reside in the search. In your knowledge portal or website. And again, it allow flexibility, the flexible, and allow redundancy. This is what I've mentioned in last if not mistaken, last Monday ke? Last week this week about the web taxonomy assignment. Dia boleh sebenarnya dalam taksonomi ini dia boleh redundant. Dia boleh redundant. Redundancy, for example, they will occur when two departments or two processes involve the same knowledge asset. Dua proses dia menggunakan knowledge asset yang sama. Jadi dia akan redundant. Item may be organized into multiple categories since the process same as I mentioned just now, and it should support multiple taxonomy for disparate audiences. Untuk audience that depends on the segment. Contohnya segment, kalau kita kaitkan, it can be segmentized your customer or audience based on their education background, for example, or based on expertise, or maybe based on types of search. Kita ada novice, expert, beginners, and sometimes can be depends on the fashions or style, or season or the environments of the audience. And you may use one or more different categorization approaches, but it is advisable for you to use only one category. One category. Sebab apa? Normally, customer they will strategize their search process or search activity based on their preferences, style, or strategy. Okay. For these slides, any questions? Kalau tak ada, saya proceed.
Tak ada,
Doktor.
Tak ada.
Ada ni. Kira tengah tunggu queue nak beli roti canai.
Ada.
Alright.
Yeah. Doktor nak nota ni, Doktor?
Oh, tak ada lagi eh. Kejap.
Ha.
Jap, saya sharekan. In PowerPoint, okay ya? PowerPoint slides. All done. Okay, it's PowerPoint slide. Sorry, saya lupa tadi. Alright. Then, this is the common categorization schemes, and some of these category, or categorizations have been discussed in our previous class. So basically, this is the most general or common categorizations of taxonomy. Ini yang paling biasa. Yang paling biasa. Okay, from the slide, the first one, facet based, and then subject oriented, functional, and then there's organizational and document, yeah, document type. Let's go through. Okay, di sebelah sini, ini adalah yang kita lihat, ya. Kita strukturkan taksonomi ini berdasarkan the process, ya, of creating the taxonomy from easiest to hardest. However, the category or design of taxonomy should you need to analyze the complexity of the knowledge asset, yeah, that reside in that companies. Yeah, tahap sukar ataupun mudah ataupun jenis-jenis, ya, di sini dinyatakan methods, ya, the methods of taxonomy, yeah, for construction, yeah, of taxonomy should look at the types of knowledge asset, yeah, that you will identify from the organization. Yeah, jadi kita lihat dia tidak semestinya menggunakan macam yang you buat sebelum ni, menggunakan organizational ataupun tree, ya, the tree style or structure, ya. Tree style tu maknanya dia ada menggunakan pyramid system, ya, yang di atas tu top, then middle and lower structure. It's not necessary. Okay, let's go through number one, facet base. Facet base, normally information categorized into multiple taxonomies or known as taxonomies, based on unique but pervasive characteristics, including topics, function, and etc. Okay, for example, in this slide, yeah, di sini kita agihkan, ini adalah production of milk by a company. Yeah, production of milk by the company. So, milk by region, which mean dia mengikut, yeah, di mana penghasilan produk tenusu mengikut geographical location. So, this is the knowledge domain by region, and then this is the geographical location. From superordinate, superordinate which mean the umbrella, yeah, kepada subordinate, yeah, the smallest components, yeah, of geographical location which refer to the milk production just now. Okay, next, milk by types, yeah, by type. So there are the cold milk, and then for cold milk there are the lactose free dan sebagainya, and then milk by price and etc and etc. So facet base tend to organize the knowledge domain according to stack technique, ya, sebab itu dinamakan di sini sebagai stackonomics. Stack, ya, stack ni mengikut index, ya, SN index. Okay, index, ya, tetapi dia mengikut priority, ya, mana yang the superordinate dia akan letakkan di sebelah atas, ya, ataupun the main, and then superordinate as the sub component, ya, of that particular asset. Okay, number two, subject oriented. Information in subject oriented normally categorized by subject or topics. Yeah, there are two techniques, yeah, in subject oriented. Number one, instantive, where each child category, kita panggil child category, which means the subcomponent category, is an instance of the parent. Maknanya ada satu parent, kemudian pecahan-pecahan ataupun the sub component itu di bawahnya, as a superordinate, subordinate, sorry. And then partitive, each child category is part of the parent category. So basically, it is subject oriented is the way that you organize mengikut priority juga. Contohnya, okay, di sini kita letakkan water pollution soil pollution and air pollution. So what will be the parent category of this taxonomy?
Pollution.
Yes. Yeah. So the parent is pollution lah kat sini ya. Ah, yang di atas tu dia pollution. Tetapi ada juga yang menyusun secara partitif, yeah, which mean the child category is part of the parent category. Mungkin dia tak gunakanlah parent macam yang tadi, insentif parent tu di sini, yeah, parentnya. Tetapi dalam hal ini partitif, mungkin dia susun secara table, yeah, secara table. Parentnya di sini, and then the child category ataupun the sub componentnya tu di sini. Boleh juga sub componentnya di sini, and then the parent kategorinya di sebelah sini, di sebelah kanan. Okay, faham ya, Yani?
Faham, Master.
Okay, dia mudah ya, study oriented mudah. Dia based on parent subject. Ini biasanya kita dapat lihat dalam subject cataloging, subject as a subject. So kita lihat subjek itu berdasarkan komponen-komponen ini. Okay, next functional, yeah, functional. Information categorized by the process to which it's relate to functions, yeah, of the units or organization. For example, employment, staffing, training. And kat sini kita boleh tak kita melihat kepada fungsi? Yeah, dalam organisasi. Cuba kaitkan dengan web taxonomy yang you dah buat tempoh hari. Dalam web taxonomy tu saya lihat ada antara anda semua yang buat melihat kepada fungsi. Fungsi which mean the process. Yeah? Process that involve in certain department or unit in that particular organization. Dia berbeza dengan organizations. If organizational, normally kita categorize the taxonomy based on departments or business entity. Yeah, the name, yeah, the name or the label of the department. Contohnya, human resource, marketing, accounting and research. But for functional, yeah, in this case, they refer to the process of or the functions of human resources. Yeah, in this example, di sini dinyatakan organizational human resources. But what will be the functions? What is the functions of human resources in that particular department? Contohnya di sini, human resource, they handle employment, staffing and training. This is the three activities or process normally occurs in human resource departments. Yeah, and then what about marketing? What is the activities for marketing department? Apa dia? Okay, advertising. Yeah, mungkin yes, promotion, mungkin media promotion, social media promotion, yeah, dan sebagainya. Yes, sales. And then what about accounting?
Reconciliation.
Yes, yeah, reconcile. And then apa lagi yang ada? Ya, yeah, mungkin ada business plan, ya, apa lagi dan sebagainya, begitu juga research dan department-department yang ada, and finally documentat, information categorized by the types of document. For example, documents for presentations, report, press release, ada yang kata apa tu newspaper cutting dan sebagainya. Jadi ini document type ni dia normally will only categorize documents, yeah, asset, yeah, sebagai documents, yeah, sebagai dokumen sahaja. Jadi boleh faham yang lima ni, yeah. Jadi kalau you refer to your previous assignment, the web taxonomy. Yang itu saya just release you and it depends on you how to construct your taxonomy. But then after this topic, yeah, after today class, I hope you can identify how to create or to construct taxonomy based on methods and types of knowledge assets provided by or identified in that particular organization. Ya, jadi selepas ini, taksonomi yang dihasilkan perlu melihat kepada komponen-komponen ini. Ya, dan lihat apa maklumat yang ada. Ya, daripada situ, barulah you pilih apakah method yang sesuai untuk to develop or to construct your taxonomy and their components. And I noticed that for your web taxonomy, most of you tend to produce organizational and facet-based taxonomy. But majority you hasilkan dalam bentuk organizational. Yeah, you buat structure yang pyramid kan? Dia ada top and then middle and lower. Yeah, most of you produce three level. Yeah. Jadi sebenarnya ini adalah teknik yang betul bila kita mengkategorikan taksonomi yang perlu dibentuk. Okay, so this is the synopsis of planning a taxonomy project. Yeah, so to plan your taxonomy project, first you need to analyze. Yeah, you need to analyze the situation. Certain analyze. So you kena buat audit lah. You kena buat knowledge audit. You pergi ke organisasi itu dan jalankan knowledge audit. Untuk you punya group project, ini yang you kena buat. Eh, tetapi ini synopsis. Tak semestinya you need to go through one by one. Yeah, this is the varieties of activities that normally occurs in taxonomy construction or development process. Okay, apa dia? It can be top down or bottom up approach. Yeah, it can be top down, which mean reports from based on the strategic directions of the organization, or it can be the recommendations by the lower management or middle management supervisor or staff. And then you need to identify the risks and challenges in that process. Yeah, especially on identify this one. Yeah. Sebelum you bentuk apa agaknya method yang sesuai, you kena kenal pasti ya apa aset-aset yang ada dan adakah dia terlalu kompleks, which mean sometimes the layer tu ataupun level tu can be more than 5. Yeah, jadi you kena minimize ya the level of taxonomy component. So yang itu ditentukan di sinilah risk and challenges. And then what's others? Apa lagi yang ada? Mungkin taksonomi yang sering bertukar, ya? Yeah? Mungkin dia selalu bertukar, dia punya domain. Jadi dia kena fleksibel lah. And then lack of understanding, ya? Yeah? Especially you, ya? Yeah? As the taxonomist, ya? Yeah? You kena faham the current situations or the environment or scenario of the organization. That's why normally you need to analyze in detail, and this is when you need the knowledge audit. Yeah, knowledge audit in place. Kena buat audit lah. Yeah? Kena tengok dan kena faham. Yeah, mungkin you buat observation. Mungkin you kena faham certain process yeah, to identify the knowledge asset. That's why for your web taxonomy, I want you to read and analyze the content of the web before you construct or develop your taxonomy domain or knowledge domain. Number 4, complexity. Yeah, complexity. So taxonomy is very complex, and you need to understand the situations. Yeah, bila complex, you kena ingat ya. Your aim is to provide assistance to the user or customer or consumer in findability, yeah, in finding knowledge for the company yeah, or organization. Jadi you must simplify this complexity. Yeah? You kena simplify. Number 5, compliance. Yeah, compliant. Dia mestilah comply kepada contohnya control vocabs or common language. Yeah, common language of the community in that particular area. And you should be ready with attitudes of staff and their user. Yeah, number six. Yeah, resistant to change. Some of them refuse to change. Why refuse? Because of many rejection, ya, rejection factor. Contohnya, kenapa? Mungkin dia rasa proses itu menyusahkan, ya, especially for the staff, ya, to apa ni kita kata, ya, untuk dia keep on update the taxonomy changes, ya, and sometime due to the attitudes of refuse to accept a new process, yeah, in, for example, productions or business activity of the organization. Yeah, mereka dah ada dalam comfort zone, so they refuse to change. Yeah, especially in creating a strategy, yeah, for information searching. Yeah. And then seven, delay and avoidance, yeah, delay of the management to approve, for example, to approve the new searching strategy or new methods of search, and avoid to accept, yeah, new policy. Yeah. Number eight, what do you need to get started? Yeah, what's your requirements? Yeah. Maybe di sini you tak ada skill yang mencukupi, ya, ataupun mungkin you perlukan training, ataupun you memerlukan equipment. But organization tend to relate taxonomy project with new technology. They tend to relate this with software. And I believe you know how much the cost, yeah, to employ KMS, yeah, knowledge management system in the whole organization, yeah. So dia bukannya murah, eh, dia sangat tinggi costnya. Jadi mereka kaitkan refuse to accept taxonomy due to cost, yeah, occurs in implementing knowledge management system for the whole organization, eh. And number nine, you need to understand your audience, yeah, which includes how they search, yeah, how they find information, and what kinds of information or knowledge asset that normally they want to or they need, yeah, in decision making process, for example, yeah. So it is important for you to understand their audience, know their segmentations, and know their profile, yeah, to provide a quality information or quality knowledge asset, yeah, in this for each segment, yeah, of audience. And then you juga kena tahu nombor 10, publisher sekiranya ada, yeah. Ini berkaitan dengan penerbitan-penerbitan, yeah, yang juga dijadikan knowledge asset of the organization. Yang ini biasanya tak susah, eh, bila penerbitan kita dah kategorikan, eh. Contohnya tadi di sini, ya, dalam kita punya structure model tadi, yang ini dia mungkin mengikut kepada dokumen, dia sebagai satu dokumen, jadi tak susah yang ini. And then understand your platform. Sometimes we can relate this with instrument, yeah, instrument for taxonomy construction. Instrument can be hardware and software, yeah. And then networking as well. Yeah. So kita melihat kepada system, yeah, readiness of the system or infrastructure to accept, yeah, or to apply taxonomy activities, yeah, which includes constructions and manipulations of taxonomy in searching of knowledge, yeah, in that particular organization. And define your use case. Yeah? Define your use cases. Yang di sini, dia sangat berkait dengan nombor 9. Eh? Di mana you kena kenal pasti apakah penggunaan. Yeah? Information or knowledge use of your user. Jadi you kena, you need to identify dia apa ya, outcome as well. Yeah, what is the outputs of the knowledge asset needed? Yeah, in the searching process. Okay, next 13 common roles and responsibility. So you have at least two teams here. Number one, your taxonomy teams, yeah, the development teams. And number two, at least you need to serve the top managements of the organization. And for some company that really have a complex structure, you need to address their middle management, for example, their manager, senior manager, and the supervisor as well. But at the same time, you must look at the lower level of the organization, which normally consists of the layman or lay worker or support staff. And that's in these levels, dia juga ada internal use. Sorry, that's one internal. But at the same time, you need to address this for external user, which mean the customer from the outside of the organization. Yeah. So the you kena lihat ya. Setiap satu tu. Apakah peranan-peranan mereka dan apakah fungsi ya, setiap unit ya, yang terlibat membangunkan, dan pada yang sama ada juga grup lain yang akan menggunakan. And then number 14, iterative design plan. Ya, iterative design plan. So to design the taxonomy display, you must be creative enough to provide, for example, graphical user interface in creating the as a middleware between user and the machine, yeah, user and the taxonomy. So apa agak representation di sini? Bagaimana you nak design the whole plan? Yeah, how to design the plan, and that represent, for example, the organization, and they represent the knowledge assets, and the taxonomy also present different segments of the user. Jadi terlalu di sini dia kadang-kadang terlalu kompleks. Number 14, communications, education, and marketing. This is how you promote the taxonomy project being developed in that particular organization. First, you need to communicate your plan. Yeah, you need to communicate your plan to the whole organization, and you must provide training. This is part of education process. Yeah, education. You jadikan dia. You need to cultivate this taxonomy use as the culture in that particular organization. And number three, marketing. Ya, yeah, marketing. Ini di mana you perlu membuat roadshow, you perlu membuat selalu membuat galakan, motivasi kepada staff ataupun user to use your services. 16, governance plan. Yeah. So for a governance plan, always look at the four keys to governance. Yeah, this very relate, to governance process lah. Jadi apa agaknya empat apa ni kunci kepada tadbir urus ni? Anybody? Ni masing-masing dah lama dalam industri. Yeah, ada sesiapa? Apa agaknya for governance plan? Yeah, what is the four key of governance? Apa dia?
Management, top management.
Yeah. Sorry.
Top management, employee.
Employees. Satu lagi. What about the user? So governance ini tadbir urus, ya, yeah, tadbir urus melibatkan satu sistem, ya, yeah, melibatkan satu sistem tadbir urus. Dia kompleks lah, eh, bila tadbir urus maknanya ada macam yang saya nyatakan tadi, ya, yeah, dia ada top management and then lower middle management, lower level management and then the support staff, eh. So part ini perlu ada, eh, di dalam you punya taxonomy project, ya, eh. Ini sebagai plan, sama ada penglibatan mereka ni sebagai user ataupun that provide will provide you with the input of the taxonomy project. So you must look or address this four different groups, ya, yeah, which also known as four keys to governance, ya, yeah, best practice of governance in organization, in an organization. Jadi empat perkara itu yang kita sebenarnya kita lihat dalam pyramid system sebagai satu strategi pengurusan perlu dilihat, ya, yeah, dalam pembangunan dan taxonomy, ya, yeah, project. 17, end user focus. When constructing this taxonomy element and the domain, you must position yourself as the end user. Ya, yeah, walaupun background you ni datang dari pelbagai contohnya, but you must position yourself as the end user. So think as the end user. That's why we need this end user focus. Or sometimes some books, yeah, they prefer to use the term as dipanggil customer driven or user oriented. Yeah, jadi dia mestilah berteraskan pengguna. Yeah, berteraskan pengguna. Janganlah you sebagai seorang guru, you berfikir dalam konteks you adalah guru. Contohnya baru-baru ni saya ada buat audit pusat sumber sekolah. Kebanyakan guru pusat sumber sekolah ni adalah guru perempuan, betul tak? Ya, yeah, guru media perempuan kebanyakannya, kan?
Betul.
Amir lelaki ke?
Ha, so dekatnya ada dua je lelaki. Ya. Yeah.
Hafiz.
Amir Hafiz je.
Ha.
Ha. Hazli lelaki perempuan. Jadi kan bila kita menilai, kita tengok kebanyakan pusat sumber dia warna pink ataupun purple. Dia punya pusat sumber tu dia mesti ada tema pink purple dengan curtain.
Macam tahu dah semua siapa.
Hijau doktor.
Jadi
saya hijau doktor. Hijau.
Dengan apa ni, curtain yang apa, colourful, ropol-ropol sama cakap tu. Tapi ada satu dua tu yang saya tengok library dia hipster. Yeah, library dia hipster kan, dia punya apa, shilling dia cat warna hitam dengan lampu oren. Bila saya tengok, oh, dia punya guru pun sumber dia lelaki. Amir, pusat sumber warna apa?
Warna oren biasanya kot.
Oh, ini macam tak pernah masuk je.
Dah muda.
Begitulah, eh. So ini kita adakah kita buat atau mengikut selera kita ataupun mengikut selera pengguna contohnya, eh. Jadi kita melihat kepada faktor ini juga. Kadang faktor tu nampak simple, eh, tetapi dia influence, yeah, the apa ni, service ataupun numbers of user, yeah, for each services. It's not necessary for the library, yeah, but sometimes all, yeah, all business organization they tend to mislead, yeah, in terms of providing the best quality services, yeah, the best quality services for the end user. Ini berlaku di mana-mana. Kadang-kadang banyak contohnya kita apa dalam penghasilan produk, eh, kita tidak melihat kepada pengguna, eh, dalam konteks memasarkan dan mengeluarkan produk itu sendiri. Okay, and then leverage existing metrics. Kadang-kadang ini dah ada. Knowledge asset ini telah dikategorikan. Ada yang passive and there's also active. And it is your decision whether to include only the active knowledge asset in your taxonomy or you need to include the passive as well in the project. So it is your choice, but it depends on the management's or depends on the company itself. They want to include or not. Sometimes yes, but sometimes due to the complexity of the knowledge asset, they refuse to include this passive knowledge asset ya, in the taxonomy project. Di sini peranan you adalah you consult them. You need to advise them maybe based on your experience or based on your analysis. You need to advise them whether to include or not. Okay, so what is the best solution here for number 18? You were the consultant. So what do you think? Ya, macam mana? Adakah you nak mereka masukkan passive asset in taxonomy, in the taxonomy project or not? What do you think? Ya, sorry, siapa jawab tu? Siapa boleh bantu kat sini?
Tak clear lah soalan doktor tadi.
Tak clear? Okay. Ya, sekiranya you adalah consultant in this taxonomy project, you akan advise. Ya, sama ada apakah keputusan you di sini ya? Adakah you akan advise passive taxonomy domain ataupun passive knowledge asset dimasukkan ke dalam taxonomy ataupun tidak? Boleh faham soalan saya?
Boleh.
So knowledge asset ni dia ada yang passive, dia ada yang active. Kalau kita nak masukkan pasif, maknanya dia akan berkemungkinan besar tidak digunakan ataupun jarang digunakan. Jadi bagaimana?
Better tak payah kot sebab dia akan jadi macam overload pula. Macam terlalu banyak. Sedangkan yang aktif tu pun dah banyak kita nak leveragekan dia. Kita tambah yang pasif pula dah lah jarang digunakan. Lepas tu kita nak kena construct pula yang pasif tu.
Okay.
Macam nak suggest lah.
Yeah, so ini Jasia punya opinion ya. What about others?
Doktor, saya saya rasa kita kena consider juga kot pasif ni. Walaupun tak aktif guna dia still lagi knowledge asset yang maybe akan digunakan, still kena consider lah untuk bina taxonomy ni.
Yes, yeah. Okay. Hafiz, terima kasih. Ada lagi yang lain? Ni macam mana ni draw ni? Ada lagi yang lain? Sorry, Nazli.
Setuju dengan
Hafiz. Okay. Setuju dengan Hafiz. Lagi? Ada lagi?
Bagi saya, dia kena letak saja kot sebab
kena letak.
Knowledge asset of the organisation bagi saya.
Okay.
Walaupun active atau passive, dua-dua tetap knowledge asset.
Yes. Ya. Yeah. Okay, so macam tu tetapi kita sebagai consultant kita kena observe juga sebab apa? Walaupun kita boleh letak dua-dua, kadang-kadang dia terlalu kompleks. It depends on the scenario. That's why you need to analyze the situations. And do not worry because if I mentioned just now, taksonomi dia fleksibel dan dia boleh di amend setiap berapa tempoh yang tertentu. You boleh letakkan dan you tak boleh, you tak mungkin you perlu letakkan juga. It depends on the situation. Contohnya kalau dia terlalu kompleks, mungkin you just omit first. But then after that, when you realize that there's a need for the user or for the management, for example, to add, to access those information, then you need to include. But it's up to your policies actually. You need to observe and identify the current needs, yeah, current needs of the user. Kadang-kadang boleh, kadang-kadang tak boleh, and it depends on the organization. This is why you need to conduct knowledge audit, yeah, bergantung kepada management juga. Ya, kita hanya menasihatkan, contohnya kalau kita dah identify benda itu terlalu kompleks, then there's no need for you or for them to include in that taxonomy project. Okay, next. Top down versus bottom up approach. Top down, for example, okay, yang ini saya dah bincangkan tadi dalam senarai ini. Yeah. Jadi saya dah bincang sepintas lalu. Saya rasa tak perlu untuk saya discuss yang ini one by one. Ini adalah penerangan, tetapi saya dah discuss kebanyakannya tadi sepintas lalu di sini. Yeah. So again, just to refresh. Kita ada top down and bottom up, yeah, sama ada daripada smallest part, yeah, smallest part, which mean bottom up, yeah, smallest to the umbrella, or from the broad to smallest category, yeah. Nanti you baca je lah. Ini pun risk and challenges as part of the taxonomy project, yeah. And just to remind you, each taxonomy construction, they have different risks and challenges. Nah, inilah peranan you untuk buat knowledge audit, yeah, which also includes sometimes survey and observations. Yeah. So ini kita dah discuss. Lack of understanding juga saya dah terangkan tadi. Walaupun penerangan saya mungkin berlainan daripada slide ini, tapi basically it is the main concern, yeah, of the issues. Alright, complexity. Nanti you baca je lah ya ni. Compliance. Ah yeah, for compliance there are the standards, yeah. So please make sure you follow to a certain standard. For example, for apa ni, control vocab, yeah. For control for vocab, it is actually necessary, yeah, for you to refer to manual or standards, yeah, in identifying the component for knowledge taxonomy, yeah, for the taxonomy. Yeah. So, jadi ini adalah antara standard-standard yang ada. Okay, what next? Resistant to change. Tadi ya, kenapa dia menolak atas faktor-faktor ini. Tapi yang ini nanti you baca. Ini saya rasa you dah level masters, memang you boleh menerangkan ini dengan mudah lah. Eh, apa faktor-faktor penolakan tersebut. Delay and avoidance. Okay, ada yang nak tanya yang ini, delay? Saya rasa okay lah ya. Yang ini very straightforward. Okay, what do you need to get started? Yeah, this is the component, as I said just now, technology. But there's also a need for you to identify your audience, the publisher or the content manager, and then the technology itself, content, scopes and resources. Yeah, resources that you need in this project. Resources can be the staff itself, yeah, the worker. The worker or the team project. Okay, content ini adalah content taxonomy. Content yang bagaimana? Adakah you nak melihat kepada functions, for example, functions or operations, you know, operation taxonomy, or it can be by department, contohnya kat sini. Okay. Understands your audience. This is the example of analysis, yeah, done to identify or to understand the audience. First, mereka ni siapa? Siapa mereka? Adakah dia new employee? Yeah, ataupun dia tenure employee? Adakah di kalangan mereka tu yang mempunyai skill yang rendah dalam penggunaan ICT, for example? What is the category of these employees in terms of IT, ICT skill? Adakah dia apa ni, novice, beginners, expert, or sometimes phobia, yeah, phobia of IT? Adakah juga technophile ni, ni ketagihan, ya, ketagihan kepada teknologi, ketagihan kepada internet, ya, contohnya. Young and old, for example. And then native speaker of foreign language speaker speaking. Eh. Jadi perkara-perkara ini contohnya adalah spektrum, eh, yang biasa kita gunakan, eh, dalam mengenal pasti keupayaan ataupun ability of your audience or user, eh, of taxonomy. Okay, so to understand your publisher, yeah, in case you need to identify the publisher's so-called apa, publisher punya category, yeah, category. Ini especially, yeah, bila berkaitan dengan maklumat berbentuk apa ni, dokumen, yeah, documents. Okay, next. Alright, this is the platform just now. Yeah, platform, adakah you mempunyai portal tertentu untuk digunakan sebagai taksonomi tersebut? Yeah, adakah dia bersifat content management? Yeah, which mean taksonomi as your content management system or content management portal? Or is taksonomi as the document management which manage only document? Taxonomy itu adalah dokumen semata-mata. Ya, dia tidak melihat kepada knowledge asset yang apa, intangible contohnya. Adakah dia juga dia sebagai satu record management? Is a record management concept? Or as a portal? Ini yang biasa, yang diamalkan di kebanyakan organisasi, dia sebagai satu portal. Ya, sebagai taxonominya berbentuk portal. Ataupun dia berbentuk enterprise. Ya, enterprise which mean di dalam bentuk website or web based or online databases. Okay, ya, jadi kita lihat kepada diagram ini, dia ada yang less complex, ya, very basic, ya, contohnya web and portal, dia very basic, and then there will be also complex, ya, with high or more complexities and tighter in terms of the taxonomy construction process. Jadi, kalau dalam penggunaan apa ni, proses transaksi sistem, kita dapat lihat dekat sini, ya, DM, RM normally they bit expensive, yeah, in term of spending, ya, yeah, ataupun financial allocation, they bit expensive compared to web or portal of the company, ya, yeah, when you refer taxonomy as a product, ya, yeah. Jadi berapa agaknya kos kat sini? Contohnya MT, MTDC, ya, yeah, MTDC dia menghasilkan content management and they spend for 1.2 or 1.3 million, ya, yeah, in that system, yeah, knowledge management system alone, ya, yeah. Jadi kat situ KMS ni is part of the taxonomy project, ya, yeah, knowledge taxonomy project. Okay, saya dah discuss tadi yang ini. Define juga. Eh, saya dah bincangkan. Okay, so ini, tadi. Apakah roles and responsibility of the team members. Kat sini kita lihat telah dipecahkan the governance board. Governance tabi urus of the project. And then the taxonomy team, the taxonomy team that develop or construct the taxonomy for the organization. And then content manager, the person who validates, validates and approve the content. And number four, the content owner which publish content and apply metadata. So content owner is the departments or the person that in charge of the taxonomy process. Okay, so sekali lagi saya ingatkan di sini kita mempunyai sekurang-kurangnya empat penanggungjawab, empat components of taxonomy governance. Tadi urus dalam taxonomy. Siapa dia? Tadi governance board normally kalau dalam government sector kita ada steering committee biasanya dipanggil. Steering committee. Dia mungkin part of that committee adalah top management. Tetapi dia adalah steering committee. Setengah yang lain dalam perkhidmatan skim kerajaan juga dipanggil technical committee. Technical committee. Itu dia fungsi dia hampir sama. Kemudian taxonomy team. Kalau di sini you menjadi taxonomist in this project, so you will fall under this category as a taxonomy team. Content manager, it can be you itself because you semua ni adalah contohnya you adalah manager of the resource center. You in charge of this resource center. So you will be the content manager of the document. Sorry, of the taxonomy. Dan akhirnya adalah content owner which provide input to your taxonomy.
Dalam National Archive ada taxonomy dia tersendiri tak, Prof?
Okay, kalau bisa kata normally archive ni dia ada standard. Dia ada standard, dia ada classification scheme juga kan? So kalau dia ada classification scheme, dia menggunakan classification scheme, kita tak panggil dia sebagai taxonomy lah. Sebab dia hanya menjurus kepada apa agaknya objek dia. Apa objek maklumat dia?
Dokumen,
dokumen, manuskrip. Tapi dia, dia capture tak yang knowledge yang dalam bentuk intangible. Ada tak ada simpan kat situ skill, knowledge, experience, ada tak? Tak ada kan? Tak, dia tak hanya ada. Dia hanya satu part. Tetapi sekiranya archive need to capture the expertise of the archive employees, for example, their experience, and they create a portal for that. So dia ada kedua-dua. Maknanya dia ada tangible information or knowledge, and at the same time they capture the intangible one. So dia ada dua-dua. That one kita boleh panggil taxonomy. Sebab apa? Yang tangible dia gunakan classification scheme. Intangible dia create based on taxonomy process. Okay, boleh?
Dia ada related dengan job description tak? Every position dia ada terangkan what is the job description untuk satu post tu.
Okay.
Ada umum kait dengan taxonomy.
Yes, as a taxonomist, you need to identify the knowledge domain that maybe ada dalam job scope itu. Ini dalam penghasilan dalam penghasilan taxonomy kita melihat, kita kena tengok scope perkhidmatan mereka, scope perkhidmatan, dan kita juga kena tengok dia punya kepakaran. Contohnya macam mana kita nak tahu seorang staff itu, contohnya seorang staff itu dia knowledgeable and expert in certain area. Contohnya macam mana agaknya?
Based on their qualification.
Okay, pertama mungkin dia based on their professional qualification. Okay, kalau dalam PDRM contohnya. So macam mana you nak tahu dia tu pakar dalam hal tersebut? Pertama dia mungkin melalui tadi the backgrounds of education or professional qualification or sometime courses attended, eh? Training dia apa semua. Okay, lagi apa agaknya?
Sometime the unit itself memang train ataupun memang dah selected. For example, nak masuk specialist on pergi air unit kan, air wing.
Contohnya, okay.
Dia kena ada basic on fizik, kimia, advanced, and then baru dia serap dalam air wing tu, and then ada extend courses lah.
Yeah.
Kan? So, training semua.
So kalau di sini, kita berbalik pada yang nota awal tadi, dia melihat kepada functions. The functions of the department. Or the process in that department. Okay, apa lagi agaknya yang ada? Mungkin kita boleh lihat di sini number of cases yang dia handle. Number of cases. Ini berkaitan lah contohnya macam apa bahagian marketing kan, berapa banyak case yang dia siasat, bagi banyak yang dia selesai. Saya rasa ini pun you punya reward system pun mungkin melihat kepada ini. Banyak yang case diselesaikan mungkin dia cemerlang contohnya kan. Dia excellent in that process. So dia jadi lama-lama jadi pakar contohnya.
KPI lah.
Yes. Jadi itulah peranan taxonomist. Dia kena tengok semua komponen-komponen ini sebelum kita menggelaskan dia tu dalam komponen contohnya expert in certain area. Sebab contohlah kat sini you nak letakkan siapa you punya narcotic expert for PDRM. Jadi you kena tengok perkara-perkara tu. Dia mungkin tak display, tetapi you need to analyze document. You need to identify previous cases, for example.
From the organizational structure, dia ada dia punya rank-rank itu. So from that also kita boleh develop the taxonomy, kan, Prof? I mean like kalau macam narcotic director, bawah narcotic director tu deputy director, and then ada yang pakar AMLA contohnya, and then untuk nak identify which is drug yang type of drug apa semua.
Boleh. Tetapi itulah kita kadang-kadang di, macam di Malaysia ni kita ramai sangat yang claim pakar dalam area, tetapi sebenarnya dia mungkin hanya boleh bercakap. Dia hanya boleh bercakap tetapi technicality of the process or technicality of the knowledge tu dia tak ada. Kadang-kadang dia macam tu. Sebab apa? Dia mungkin boleh bercakap, so dia represent as a PRO of the of the organisation kan. Tapi untuk mendapatkan specialist ataupun expert in that in that area, you kena tengok lagi lah. Walaupun dia dalam organisasi, tapi tak semestinya dia pakar dalam bidang tu. Ini biasanya macam tu juga dalam universiti pun. Contohnya dia PNC research. Dia orang yang tertinggi dalam research di UiTM, tetapi dia mungkin dia bukan expert dalam research area, but they know how to govern or manage organisation.
Okay, betul. Betul lah, bukan semua doktor boleh sunat budak kan.
Saya boleh ya. Kalau tuan nak sunat boleh tak? jangan minta MC ke saya. Okay. So kita teruskan. Alright. So ini adalah iterative design. Tetapi macam saya explain tadi, dia tidak semestinya mengikut flow. Tetapi ni yang basic. Pertama, you kena plan, you need to discover. Discover ni, you buat nulis audit lah. And then, you need to form your taxonomy team. And then, form the focus group. Apa dia focus group? Daripada focus group ini, you akan identify apa agaknya knowledge yang ada. Ataupun knowledge activity that involve in each business activity. Or each business process of the organization. Focus group ini bukan kita. Focus group ini adalah employees of the organization or the stakeholders. Stakeholders of the organization that they performs daily activity. They run the business activity of the organization, so they know the types of knowledge may be created from that activity or types of knowledge that might be used in that activity. Jadi kat sinilah Ini elemen ini sangat penting ya. Elemen mana? Elemen yang ini ya, yang okey saya tandakan kat sini. Ini untuk ingat ya, yang lain semua kena ingat ya. Ini focus group ini adalah antara step kita untuk identify the knowledge assets of the organization. Ya. So apa agaknya focus group? What is focus group? You dah ambil paper research methodology?
Dah ambil dah.
Sedih je. Kenapa Dr. Mahir marah you?
Tak ada.
Okay. So apa agaknya? Yeah.
Tapi doktor dia sebut pasal stakeholder kan? Dalam taksonomi ada beza ke stakeholder dengan shareholder?
Shareholder can be stakeholder.
Maknanya sama je lah.
Yeah. Shareholder, dia adalah kita katakan di sini dia sebagai investor contohnya. Dia pelabur. Dia mengeluarkan capital yeah, for certain company. Yeah, dia mengeluarkan capital for certain company. Contohnya apa ya? Okay, contoh Malaysia Airlines. Yeah, Malaysia Airlines. Siapa agaknya shareholder bagi Malaysia Airlines? Contohnya kita ada Khazanah Malaysia, Khazanah Nasional. Khazanah adalah shareholder of Malaysia Airlines. Shareholder ini dia adalah pemegang capital. Yeah, capital modal yang mengeluarkan modal bagi operasi Malaysia Airlines. Dia invest, dia inject duit dekat situ. Tetapi siapa stakeholder? Stakeholder ini adalah parties, parties, maybe parties ni apa ya, unit-unit ataupun entity yang terlibat, semua entity yang terlibat dalam sesuatu organisasi. Contohnya siapa? It can be the top management, it can be the middle, it can be employees, it can be supplier, vendor, user dan sebagainya. All parties involved in the business activity of the organization. Alright, your question. Can shareholder be part of stakeholder contohnya? Yes. Sebab apa? They invest capital in that company. Okay, yes ya?
Okay, doctor.
Okay, back to my question. Focus group. Pernah buat focus group? Tahu tak apa itu focus group?
Kalau dalam research tu intended respondent kita lah. Maksudnya target group untuk kita punya research.
Okay. Focus group is one of the research methodology. It's one types of research methodology. Ya, dia adalah satu kaedah penyelidikan focus group. Ya? Siapa dia punya respondent? Contohnya, kalau you buat data collection di sekolah, you ada different group, right? Group apa? Contohnya kita ada group mengikut tingkatan, mungkin mengikut kelas, mungkin mengikut jantina. Jadi untuk proses pengumpulan data, you kena identify respondent from these different groups. Yeah? You pull them and then letakkan satu tempat. Yeah? You kumpulkan dia ni, letakkan, kemudian you mungkin buat groups interview. You buat interview secara beramai-ramai. Yeah? Mungkin you buat secara storytelling to capture the input from these different groups. Alright? So, focus group is one of the qualitative strategy in research activity. Yeah. So, after focus group, barulah you construct or build your taxonomy dan seterusnya. Okay? Okay, seterusnya tadi kita kita bangunkan. Kita test, kita review. Ini peranan tadi ya, yang untuk validate the content. And then tag content, ini untuk memudahkan proses searching. You kena buat tag of the term. And then finally, maintain and evolve. Yeah? Depends on the policy of the taxonomy, and it depends on the knowledge activity in that particular organization. Yeah? So this is the normal design or iterative design taxonomy in business activity, yeah, or business company. Okay, so ini communication, education and marketing. Saya dah rumuskan tadi apa agaknya yang biasa dilakukan dalam proses to cultivate the culture of employing knowledge corporate taxonomy in that particular organization. Yeah, of course, when it's a new thing that you need to introduce in organization, then dia adalah kena adalah education ataupun educate. You need to educate the audience or the employees of the company. Alright, next, governance. Yeah. So apakah governance? Yeah, as I mentioned, governance dalam bahasa Melayu kita panggil tabib urus. Yeah, siapa yang terlibat? So apply the core governance principle to your taxonomy and metadata strategy. Yeah, first you need to identify the roles and responsibility of the team members, and then you need to set up a policy, and then the procedure. Roles and responsibility. Contohnya, you are the taxonomy managers. You are the taxonomist itself. The taxonomist ni adalah orang ataupun individu yang produce the taxonomist. Yeah, they identify and produce the taxonomist. And the reviewers, they will review and refine the taxonomist component or knowledge component that produced by your team. Pada masa yang sama, you need to set a policy. Policy bagaimana untuk to standardize the name, standardize the field, or to create the taxonomy component for that organization. Yeah, domain apa yang dihasilkan. Yeah, semua itu diletakkan dalam policy. Supaya apa? Supaya contohnya bila you berhenti daripada projek ini, ada orang lain yang boleh baca you punya dokumen dan dia faham proses itu mengikut satu standard yang ditetapkan. Ya. Untuk polisi ini, dia sangat berkait dengan prosedur, because normally we depends on prosedur and policy to create our taxonomy. Jadi di sini ya, kedua-dua ini memerlukan standard. And for taxonomy, you need to create the standards specifically for your project. Boleh tak kita refer to other organization? Yes, you can, but as the guidance only. Why? Because each organization they unique. Yeah, it depends on the culture, it depends on the business process, and it depends on the environments of the organization. Jadi you tak boleh simply copy other company manual or standard. Tetapi you boleh benchmark to learn the process or to identify the components of that standard. Yeah, yang ini saya dah explain and user tadi, tak ada salah. Okay, so ini matrix tadi, passive and active. Jadi kita ada cara lah bagaimana untuk kita identify active and passive taxonomy. Jadi persoalannya tadi, kalau tak digunakan, adakah kita akan retain? It depends on the policy of the organization. You as the consultant, you may advise them. Kalau bukan consultant pun, you sebagai developer, you perlu melihat kepada keseluruhan proses tersebut. Alright, so that's all for today. Questions?
Back to our final project, Prof.
Yeah.
Do we need to cari yang any company yang belum ada taxonomy dan kita develop taxonomy untuk company itu, right?
Yeah. And the company you boleh replicate, which mean you may create imaginary company. Contohnya, you boleh create sendiri.
I see.
Ataupun you boleh identify any company as a case. But the idea here is to propose a new taxonomy for that corporate organisation.
Okay.
Kena tengok eh. Saya nak tengok di sini corporate organisation. Corporate, which mean they deal business activity. So saya tak nak NGO, saya tak nak government. Kita nak lihat kepada corporate sector.
Yang ada making profit lah, business yang making
profit. Maknanya dia ada produk dan dia ada services dan dia ada business activity.
Macam lawyer firm boleh ke?
Yes, they provide services.
Okay.
Kedai lah.
Yeah?
Kedai sebuah
Kita boleh tak identify dia sama ada dia adalah korporat. Jangan makcik jual goreng pisang nak buat. So maknanya contohnya kalau macam 7-Eleven ke apa, tu boleh lah sebab dia besar kan, dia komponen yang banyak kan.
I see, thank you.
Jangan pula makcik jual goreng pisang depan rumah tu you nak buat taksonomi. Jadi limited, very limited
nanti. 99 Speedmart pun okey lah kan, 99 Speedmart.
Boleh. Tapi dekat sini saya tak nak tengok semata-mata produk . Bila kita kata korporat tu dia melibatkan governance, tadbir urus, melibatkan kepakaran, melibatkan contohnya branches, hubungan luar dia, macam tu, ada CSR. Jadi kalau itu baru kita nampak secara menyeluruh.
CSR apa tadi mention CSR tu? Stand for what CSR?
Apa dia ni? Amiruddin, CSR.
CSR apa?
CSR. Itu macam lebih kurang kejamal lah macam bukan.
Customer service relationship.
Customer service.
Okay.
Customer service lah, betul lah.
Corporate
social responsibility.
Corporate responsibility social.
Apalah cikgu-cikgu ni.
Kebajikan. Ramai dekat tadi.
Corporate responsibility.
Corporate social responsibility. So CSR ini dia bukan monetary. Dia bukan bersifat monetary, tetapi dia lebih kepada promoting your organization. You nak promote organisasi itu secara CSR. It's a marketing strategy actually. Okay, ada lagi yang nak tanya?
Tanya nanti doktor, tak nak buat bila dah tak
faham.
Nak buat.
Tak faham, itulah biasa. Nanti last minute, nanti saya block semua nombor.
Tak ada, last minute.
Jangan tak doktor.
Doktor tunggu soalan kita orang.
Okay. Alright, so itu saja kelas kita hari ini. Tak ada apa-apa.
Saya baik dah jawab sumpah doktor.
Ya, yeah, okey dah tu.
Jawab terima.
Doktor, slide ni dalam You Future dia tak macam exactly macam you punya slide ni lah yang I punya You Future tu.
Tak apa, saya share tadi kan dalam apa ni? Dalam WhatsApp.
Wah, WhatsApp.
Dalam WhatsApp saya share. Nanti saya pun boleh download daripada situ lah.
Okey doktor, thank you.
Alright. So kalau tak ada apa, kita jumpa lagi kelas akan datang. Nanti attendant jangan lupa ya. Okay, terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Terima kasih.